All right, well, thank you for being here, and you know, it's been a pleasure that we have been getting together the last couple times that we have. You know, it's always good to be in fellowship as we're just witnessing. We're like sharing testimonies and we encourage each other. And, you know, it's just a summer rhema, right?
Summer rhema,
yeah. Jumping in the river, the blood, we're getting a royalty.
Yeah.
No, but it's been good, and we just thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming, and we just thank you that you're having your way with us.
Yes.
Have our hearts open to receive from you. And Lord, I just pray that we receive from your word, and we receive some new perspectives on your word, Father God. And just, we thank you, Lord. Thank you for being here in the midst of us. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so if you got your hand up, we got healing wings.
Okay.
And of course, you see me wearing my talit that I've gotten from my brother and sister straight from Israel.
Straight from Israel.
And this, we're gonna touch a little bit upon that, just, you know, a tiny bit. And it's pretty cool. So, talit, the Hebrew prayer shawl. Now, tall is 10 in Hebrew, and eat is little. So we can say that this is little tent. And the particular one that I'm wearing here and that we have here on the table is a messianic one, and there are different variations. And as I do this, I'm getting into my tent.
Yes.
I'm enclosing myself into my closet, as Jesus said. Get into your prayer closet.
Like get into,
there you go. Get into intimacy with the Father. Put aside distractions. Get intimate with Him. Be one with Him. In your talit. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
There you go, brother. So we're going to read the scripture here. Any volunteers? Celia, maybe?
Thank you.
Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, speak to
Children of Israel.
Say to them that they are to make for themselves tzitzit on the corners of their garments throughout their generations, and they are to put a blue cord on each tzitzit. It will be your own tzitzit, so whenever you look at them, you will remember all the mitzvah. Of Adonai, and do them, and not go spying out after your own hearts and eyes, prostituting yourselves. This way you will remember and obey all my mitzvah, and you will be holy to your God. I am Adonai, your God. I brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am Adonai, your God.
Amen. So we see a lot here. And, you know, I like the end part, too, because how many times does he say, I'm Adonai, your God? And he says, I brought you out of the land of Egypt. He's showing you, look, I brought you from the old to the new. I've given you a new opportunity. I brought you into me with me. And I really like that. But what he was pointing to, the tzitzit, the corners of his garment, of the garments, right? He wanted them to put tzitzits on the corner of the garments. So according to this scripture, God wanted the children of Israel to make borders, these corners, on their garments. So corners in Hebrew is kanaf, or if you were to say it plural, is kanafayim. A lot of time when you see the I am and the word, it's plural. So kanaf in Hebrew means wing, edge of clothing, or in this case, corner of a garment. Question. So why did Adonai want his people to add corners to their garments?
Question.
Good question, right? Keep that in mind.
I wonder, establish a family of seamstresses.
Well, as we read in this... That's good.
Yeah.
We also read that Adonai instructed for a blue string that we see here intertwined. The tech ahead to be put in each corner to be called the tzitzit. Now this blue string is made from a dye that is derived from the blood of a shellfish. I believe you pronounce it hilason, that is in the Mediterranean, but there's a lot more behind it. If we get into it, that like I guess in the times they had it, but it suddenly disappeared. So you may see tzitzits of different variations, either with a black string or with just all white strings. recently it is said that it has returned, and there's been writings also that if it returns, it's the coming of the Messiah. The coming of the Messiah is close. The Tekelhet is a reminder of God's relationship or his covenant with us and his sovereignty and his authority. It's also a reminder of the throne. As we read in Ezekiel, it says, as the appearance of a sapphire stone. So, like, we go back to the scripture here, it is to remind them as they look upon the fringes or the tzitzit that he is with them. They are to be reminded of his mitzvah, which are his commandments. The mitzvah of Adonai are his commandments. Question: why did Adonai want his people to place blue tassels on the corners of their garments? These tassels, the tzitzit here that I'm holding, are to be viewed upon and reminding them of their covenant with Adonai, and that they are set apart for a purpose. Amen. So just like I discussed, they were to look upon this and remind themselves that, hey, I'm set apart. I am in covenant with Adonai. I'm in covenant with our Father. He brought us out of the land of Egypt, right? He commanded here and said, put this on the corners of your garments to do that. Look upon it.
So, what do we have today that we wear to remind us that we are in covenant?
Cross.
Huh? Who said that?
No,
you did?
Yes.
A wedding ring. That's right. Is it there to remind me, or is it there to tell everybody else that I'm married? Both. It's there to tell people that I am covenant with someone else. And it's there to remind me that I am in covenant with that woman over there. So, to the Jewish person, they would, on their garments, God put that on there, because we are people who forget.
Yeah.
We have to be reminded. You know, we forget. So God put this on there, so when they wore those and they saw it, it reminded them, oh, I am in covenant with my Lord.
That's good, yeah.
Yeah.
That's
oh,
good.
Sorry.
Okay. No, that's good. Yeah, it's like an outward, like you said, just about the ring, the outward showing that, hey, look, oh, okay, wherever you go, I am in covenant with you.
And you can, when they had these on, like I saw in Oregon, right. Washington, you could see it under their garment sticking out.
It's supposed to be shown, yeah.
Supposed to be shown.
It's supposed to be shown. You're supposed to have
I should see it, and you should see it. Quite amazing.
All right, thought. Over the last couple of Bible studies, we've seen a glimpse of how the Hebrew letters and words hold a message, which has been pretty cool if you've been here. There is another layer of gematria, which is the numerical value, that hold a deeper meaning than what's on the surface.
That's cool.
Amen?
Yeah.
It's so cool because you get to see, like, man, a word isn't just a word. You know, it's just like we know sometimes names mean something, they're prophetic. But, you know, a lot of time the words, they're just like so deep. It's so cool, man.
Let me throw this in here. Hebrew is the only language that has three layers. It has a script, a picture form, and a numerical value. English has a script and a numerical value. Chinese has a script and a picture, no numerical value. Egyptian has script and a picture, no numerical value. But Hebrew is the only one that serves all three. And all three, when you read their numerical value, when you read their pictures, when you read the script itself, all of them tell you something.
Why not two? Why three?
Like the Trinity.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah, there you go.
That's another Bible lesson right there.
That's a whole lot. This is good.
Numerical value for the word tzitzit in Hebrew is 600.
Yes.
So here we have the actual Hebrew letter, and it's a numerical value. Of course, we read it from right to left. So we would read Sade, Yud, Sade, Yud, and Tav. That's tzitzit. All right. So the fringes or the tzitzit have five knots, which, here, I'll just this one a little intertwined. So we see five knots here. If you haven't seen one, I'm sure everyone else has seen it. We have five white knots here, right?
Uh-huh.
And I have eight strings here that hang off the edge, right?
And so why is one of them blue?
Yeah. Because one of them is Jesus.
Oh, no, my word! Wow! From the mouth of babes, holy cow!
That's the
Holy Spirit right there.
Yes, because one of them is the Messiah. Oh, wait, I'm sorry. Woo!
Amen.
And so the traditional Hebrew, they wear the blue also, not knowing it's the Messiah?
Or no, they knew it was the Messiah.
Okay, got it.
Yes, they knew it was the Messiah.
They just don't believe Yeshua is the Messiah.
Right, he was the Messiah.
He was a teacher, right?
Right. That's why he didn't say Jesus, he was the Messiah.
Right.
Right. But we know, yeah.
Okay, so you have this adding to the 600, which is the tzitzit. And then you have the 5 knots and the 8 threads. So when you add all these together, right, these individual corners, you get 613. Now, what's so symbolic or what's so significant of this number 613? What was
go
it?
Ahead, go ahead. It was commandments.
All right, so this divine number corresponds to all his 613 commandments or instructions in his word or in his Torah or Pentateuch, 5 books of Moses, whatever. But it corresponds to the 613. Right. So when you look upon this, when they, like he instructed him in Numbers 15, they were actually looking at his 613 commandments.
Yes.
Which is so cool because they were like you were saying, they were reminded wherever they go because they were commanded to wear it. They will look upon this and say, well, I'm in covenant with my Father. I'm in covenant with my God. I'm pushing away sin. I'm removing that. I'm getting away from that because I'm in covenant. Just like how we remind ourselves, men or women, you know, we are in covenant with our husband or wife. It's a reminder, because like we need reminding, yes. Right? All right, so in Hebrew, gematria, 600, stand for warfare. Okay?
Yeah.
Five stands for divine strength. Amen?
Yes.
Eight is new beginnings.
New beginnings.
So we could say one warfare in divine strength and new beginnings. Or translation, one can warfare with God's strength and all becomes new when one wears their talit.
Wow.
Amen. They're garment of praise, right? Their tent.
It's like going into your prayer closet. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Going to warfare in your prayer closet and gain God's strength, and you come out and all things are made new.
Right. Yeah. So in the gematria level, it tells you that story.
That's good. That's it's kind of like when she was talking about putting on your armor.
Yeah.
You walk out kind of in confidence in God's trust that He's with you, right?
Yeah.
I just like how the Lord had that design to keep his promises covenant ever before. And just like you were sharing with their testimony, we forget who we are.
Right.
Yeah. We forget the promises. We forget the covenant. We forget we have authority. And it's like when you're wearing that prayer shawl and you have the tzitzit and the blue with the sapphire and the throne of God, and the authority your Father gave you,
right,
that authority, it's like it's almost like we need a Christian
ZZ.
That reminds us of who we are, that we, you know, that we, because this, I know we know who we are, but I think that we need, we're visual people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We need that visual,
yes,
reminder,
yes,
to remember who,
well,
we are.
Well, that's like when I was sharing about my dream, I told him, I almost want to like type it out and draw like a big picture of what I saw, put it on my wall, so I could be reminded, you know, it is, and we are visual.
But the thing is, we are the minority in the Christian community. Because this isn't normal. If you go to a lot of places, especially from, like, in my church, you see people and they're holy, holy. By their exterior, you may think so, but what's in the interior? And they're not walking in that. They don't seem to, like, have that same, like, the spiritual presence here is so much quicker and so much more evident. The love, you know, people will know that you're mine by the way you love each other, that we're supposed to love each other, you know, me and the Father are one. We're supposed to be like that. We're supposed to, you know, if I have something that belongs to you, if you have something, I could come and use it because it's mine. We're supposed to know. You know what I'm saying? That's the way we're supposed to be. We're supposed to love each other that much. We're not there yet. But we're so much further than so many others. And I just think, I don't know, it just is like, oh, you want to get people and shake them a little bit and say, look at who you are.
Yes.
Get it. And if there was something like that that was, you could wear, I don't know, as a ring maybe that isn't so.
Maybe a creative design is kind of.
Well, I think that's why a lot of people wear the cross.
But they don't. It's
the cross gets worn by many people for a whole bunch of different reasons.
Exactly. Yeah. And then they don't see it as what we see it as. You know what I'm saying? We see it and we know he rose for me. You know, he rose for you. But the average person, oh, that's a cool cross.
Yeah.
Look at that engraving on it. I want that. And then they'll go and, you know, they'll hang it on their wall and it's just there from where, oh, yeah, that's cool. Okay. But there's no
there's like a lot of layers behind it.
Yeah. And then a lot of people do it as a worship where they're like not praising the Lord, but looking at the cross like it's not. And with the right heart, you know what I'm saying? It's like there has to be something that's a reminder, as I was saying, that they can kind of get a deeper understanding of it. I don't know.
You want to say something?
Yeah, you got a thought there.
Yeah, I know, it's like a million thoughts.
Well, the devil always takes whatever the Lord does and perverts it.
Yeah.
There you go.
Just like the cross.
Yes.
He's turned it upside down.
Right. I was going to say,
everybody who wears it, even though you know they're not a Christian, wears one. Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to see how the devil has, I'm just trying to think in my mind how the devil has perverted this. Or has the Lord kept it sacred and has not yet perverted the tallit?
Uh-huh. Well, there's a lot of tassels on clothing and things, you know.
Graduation and camp, yeah.
You wouldn't even know that signifies something.
Yeah.
You know, because it's.
Right.
It's every, you know.
Right.
You wouldn't even know.
Decor. Decor or fashion.
Yeah. It's just become,
but it means so much more now that you really look into it. I mean, there's a lot more, you know. But yeah, it's cool.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, so last on this page. The Lord wanted his word on his children at all times, like he commanded. They were to be saturated with his word, clothed in his word, abiding in his will, and wrapped in his promises.
Amen.
Amen.
I like that.
Amen.
He wants us to be wrapped in his promises rather than his word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's just like it's every part of us is to be saturated with something of the Lord.
Right.
Yeah. I think that's beautiful. I just think that's beautiful. Wrapped in his promises is like, no, you can't forget me.
Exactly, Did the word that was made flesh wear a tallit?
Did Jesus wear a tallit?
Yeshua said, do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets.
Hold on. Do you think Jesus wore a tallit?
Yes.
Wasn't he a teacher?
Yeah, but doesn't mean because he's a teacher he wore a tallit.
Didn't you need to be a rabbi?
You don't have to be a rabbi to wear a tallit.
I you know, one thing that came to mind quick, and it's probably other parts of the world.
Not to wear a tallit.
The woman at the well, when she was speaking to him, some reason as I read it, you see that she says, you being a Jew, either by his speech or by his clothing, she recognized him, right?
Yeah.
Maybe he dressed a little different. Maybe he had a tallit. Maybe she didn't. I'm not sure.
Good question. Good thought.
Good. So he said, I did not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. Matthew 5:17. So saying that, I mean, we just read in the first page that there was a commandment in Numbers 15, and, you know, Yeshua following it, and like you just said, I came to fulfill, not to destroy the law or the prophets. So Yeshua would have surely walked in the Father's will and authority wearing his
yes. Yes, because he would have came there to fulfill and walked accordingly. He would have worked with him.
In the Bible, the scriptures of the prophet Malachi transition from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant. Here we read something fascinating. The Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. Or kanaf, or kanafayim, plural, right? Malachi 4:2. Which is cool because the same word used to describe the wings of the cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant, the cherubim spread their wings, their kanaf, or kanafayim, over the place of the Ark and overshadow the Ark. So they were basically overshadowing the presence of God, right? So Yeshua coming to fulfill all the law and what the prophets wrote, you can see that the same word that described the wings on the cherubim were the same words that described the wings here as described on the tallit, and he was the very presence of the Lord, of the Lord, right? Which is kind of cool. This same word, I'm going to read that second paragraph down. This same word, kanaf, used here is the same for the corners on the kanafim of the tallit. The Messiah, being the presence of God, was wearing a tallit with healing in the four wings of his garment. We start to think of the women with the issue of blood who undoubtedly was determined to reach, touch, and receive her healing. She, along with many, understood this prophecy of Malachi 4:2.
Yeah, yeah. So she, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, she understood, being a Jewish woman, the prophecy of Malachi, that there's going to be healing in the wings of the Messiah. And she knew she didn't have to touch him. She knew she had to touch the corner of his garment.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
And I'm thinking, I'm stealing his thunder. But in the Bible, God told the nation of Israel, when you cut your fields, when you cut the field, what are you supposed to leave?
The corners.
The corners. And it says the corners are for the who?
Poor.
For the poor to come eat. So there's corners of the field that you're not supposed to touch and eat to touch at all. And you're supposed to leave it because those four corners reflect back to that tallit, that there's power, there's healing, there's substance, there's something for me in the corner of that garment. So when she touched that garment, she knew she had to touch just the corner. And it's amazing, she wasn't the only one. Many people came to Yeshua and touched the corner of that garment.
Yeah, she says they came and begged to touch the corner of the garment. You know?
Because they knew the prophecy of Malachi.
Wow.
That's good.
So when they're talking about his wings in Malachi, they're talking about the corners of his garment.
Yeah. Because that word kanaf means the corners, the wings of the garment, the corners. It's the same one used as overshadowing the Ark of the Covenant, the presence of God.
You know, growing up, you'd hear that preach and you think of these big wings.
No, I would. Yeah. When I would hear that, I think I was trying to envision Jesus with angel wings. Okay. We're under his wings, you know.
Yeah. And you know, my mind is racing. You know, and when Yeshua left and gave his mantle on the day of Pentecost to his whosoever wills, that's you and me, whoever will ask Jesus in your heart, he gave their mantle. Remember when Peter would walk by? He wouldn't even touch them. What would walk by?
Shadow.
His shadow. Wow. Like
this
a wing.
This is just a question.
Like a wing.
We're clothed, Jesus is clothed in righteousness, like
right.
A garment.
We were the
robe, clothed in
garment
light,
of praise, righteousness.
And we're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
It's like we're stepping in.
Okay, we're stepping in, but it's like it's a garment. It's a covering. It's like it looks like that in the spirit. Yeah. To leap that wraps around you, yeah. So they have light with the glory of God because he wraps the glory of the garment.
Well, that's what I was thinking about, especially because as he's speaking, I was watching as it dropped lower on his shoulders and it was just holding him like a wrap.
Well, we did, right? We've been redeemed.
Yeah.
Like Boaz to Ruth.
Yeah.
I mean, put your cloak, your skirt, your corners, your
cover me, oh,
cover me.
Yes.
Redeem me. Right. That's what we've been. We've been redeemed.
The kinsman redeemer.
The kinsman redeemer.
That's good. That's good, man.
And there's closeness and intimacy in that.
Well, it's like you said, but it's, I'm paraphrasing, oh, Jerusalem, how would I have wanted to gather you under my arms and,
right.
And like a mother hen gathers her under her wings, right? Well, it comes back to remember that we're talking about the flag, you know, modeled after the tilly. You know, like you say, he's wrapping, the flag is wrapping in Messiah's garment, which they don't even really realize it yet, but he's gathering them, like you said, he would in that scripture, like he wanted to. Amen.
You know, we were talking to Sharon earlier. I don't know if you're going to bring this up. There's nothing magical.
Mm-hmm.
In wearing the tallit. But I honestly think that when you understand it and you put your tallit on, because God understands that this was all about him, I think you get God's attention. It's just like when you decide to pray and use one of his holy names, it gets his attention. It's when you pray or speak and you use a promise back to him, it gets his attention. So I myself think when you put your tallit on, that God all of a sudden just focuses on you because you understand, you know, what it is and the holiness of it. You know, I don't think there's anything magical in it, but I think we get God's attention.
I think it's when you're doing it by faith, it's when you understand it and doing it by faith, it's I'm doing it for this purpose, I'm one with the Lord. It doesn't come to you mentally, spiritually. It's a faith thing.
Right.
I mean, I think it's
coming from within up, yeah.
Right. And I think it's sad that many of us here in the Western world don't understand the importance of knowing this. And you read the Bible, and many of us didn't know what the four wings meant. It's like, oh, that's what it means. It's significant.
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, it's basically, and then you correlate it with the woman with the 12 years. And it's like, oh, that makes sense. She knew it. She, you know, it's. It makes it more important. It makes it stand out more. Like, oh. You know, yeah.
I think it's an outward expression of obedience. The Lord notices. It's like when we see our babies doing something that we taught them and we want to see them do it, and we never get to see them do it because they're not going to show us that they do what we say. And then all of a sudden, you hear from somebody else that they're doing something, and you get to sneak and get that look. You're like, oh. They heard me, you know. I think that is I think that the Lord is like, look at my baby. They're doing it. They got it, you know. I think that probably is
that
attention. You're just wow, obedience, you know.
That's good, man. And, you know, the woman with the issue, what I've always thought was so cool, like we've talked about before, is like, you know, why not touch his hand and his beard or anything else? She, like you were saying, she understood the prophecy. And when she's... Because you got to remember, she had the issue of blood. If she was under the law, she wouldn't have been in the general population. According to Leviticus 15, she would have been secluded, isolated, kind of like a leper, right? You would have been isolated. But yet, she took a chance, she took a risk. You see, Jesus just came from healing the man with the legion of demons from the Gadarenes, and he came across, and he was met by Jairus. He said, hey, come heal my daughter, you know, the ruler of the synagogue. So he's walking this way, and here comes the crowd, because They all want to touch the Messiah. They all want to see him. They all want to, you know, right along, thronging him, right? And so she, being in isolation, says, I need my healing. I'm going to go after it at all costs. Because she knows that she's out there in general public touching people. They become unclean. She could be stoned because she's not supposed to be around. But the cool thing is that she, in desperation, went, I mean, 12 years is a long time for anything. But yet she spent all of her money. She's identity crisis, rejection, depression, whatever her case may have been, right? This is all she knows now at this point. But she hears of the Messiah coming, and he's fulfilling Malachi 4:2. I need to go out and get my healing. I'm going to go get it. So she goes, and it's funny because the scripture says that when he realizes, hey, how, you know, he touched me, and he says, hey, everybody's touching you. What are you talking about? You know, and so he felt that, he even said that power, that virtue come out of me. I felt faith. Somebody with faith around me. I know who did it, you know. And she was shaking. She was scared. Probably because, for one, she wasn't supposed to be out, and she could be stoned.
She got discovered. Yeah.
But it's cool because, like you said, faith. In all three Gospels that explain that, you know, he says, good, your faith has made you whole. You've been healed by your faith. And it's cool, too, that as soon as she touched it, she said, and she felt that it dried up, and she was made whole. I just thought, you know, I've always liked that part, you know, it's like, it's so cool that she went at all costs to go and get her healing and touch this part that they all knew so well. But yeah, here comes Messiah fulfilling all this with the power, right? With healing in his wings.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
All right, so, therefore, never be afraid to touch God. If God puts fringes on his garment, it means he is touchable. He is not afraid to be touched.
Yeah.
So touch God with your infirmities, with your wounds, your cares, your sins, and you will be transformed.
Amen.
I think we could all testify in some way that we've gotten closer to the Lord and we've been transformed. Amen.
Amen.
That you might find healing in his wings. His kanafayim. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
And the kindness, and this is, what do we do later? Admonish each other richly with the word of God and sing songs, hymns. And whatever we do to the Lord, whether word or deed, we do it, everything we do is unto him. So I think you got to take off that first, the confession part of it before we put on
that. Let's move that flesh out of the way, right?
Right.